Another term for pseudoepitheliomatous hyperplasia is pseudocarcinomatous hyperplasia. And this is a reactive hyperplasia of the epidermis that is usually to repair damage. And it is characterized by florid downward proliferation of the epidermis resembling squamous cell carcinoma, hence the term pseudoepitheliomatous or pseudocarcinomatous hyperplasia. There are numerous causes of pseudoepitheliomatous hyperplasia, and it is important to recognize them because it can give a clue as to what is causing the worrying appearance of the epidermis. So groups of conditions causing pseudoepitheliomatous hyperplasia can be divided into trauma and chronic irritation, ulcers and sinuses, infections, tumors, and some chemicals. Blastomycosis is a type of fungal infection that is frequently associated with the development of pseudoepitheliomatous hyperplasia. Other infections include chromomycosis, sporotrichosis, TB, syphilis, and granuloma inguinale. Here is an example of a fungal infection that has caused pseudoepitheliomatous hyperplasia of the skin, and this is chromoblastomycosis. Perhaps the tumour most frequently associated with pseudoepitheliomatous hyperplasia is granular cell tumour. Others include Spitz nevus, malignant melanoma, and solitary circumscribed neuroma. Pseudoepitheliomatous hyperplasia may follow burns, surgery, hidradenitis suppurativa, stasis dermatitis, pyoderma gangrenosum, and chondrodermatitis nodularis helices. And finally, bromoderma is a cutaneous reaction caused by the use of products containing bromide, and this may cause pseudoepitheliomatous hyperplasia of the skin. The lesions in pseudoepitheliomatous hyperplasia tend to be symmetrical histologically, in contrast to squamous cell carcinomas, which tend not to be symmetrical. There are thin, long, infiltrative, anastomosing strands of epithelium, and there is an abrupt transition between the pseudoepitheliomatous epidermis with the normal adjacent epidermis. The basal aspect of the epidermis has a rather jagged appearance, and there are frequent horn cysts, and these contain orthokeratin. There is lack of nuclear pleomorphism, and a frequent finding is infiltration of epidermis by inflammatory cells. And another important feature is that the subcutaneous tissue is not reached or involved by the pseudoepitheliomatous hyperplasia. This is a low power view of pseudoepitheliomatous hyperplasia, and it shows some symmetry to the lesion. On higher power you can see the long thin strands of epidermis with a rather jagged appearance to the basal aspect. Here are a couple of horn cysts, and these contain orthokeratin, that is keratin without the pycnotic nuclei. And here we can see an acute inflammatory infiltrate in the epidermis. And finally, the underlying cause of this very florid example of pseudoepitheliomatous hyperplasia is a granular cell tumour.